So apparently, some company in California is hijacking our logo, and I think we should call some people in Cupertino. Okay, so I'm taking the title that Rob had given me before. So what I'm going to tell you about is nucleoceptors, which were nicely introduced by Eric before, and I thank him for that because it saves me a lot of time. And I'm going to show you the functional profiling which we do on those receptors in an assay which we call Marconi, and especially the application of this assay in helping pharma to design better drugs. So as Eric told you before, nucleoceptors are transcription factors which are regulated by ligands, so they have a ligand binding site, and that makes them very nice for pharma. Pharma picked up on that because they're highly druggable. And so what I've done here is put down the drug development pipeline in which targets, nucleoceptors have been found as targets for many diseases, so pharma is going for that. And so in this whole pipeline, and finally they end up here where we can help them. So they're targeting nucleoceptor activity, and in the end, and that is the thing that that has become apparent, is that in the target identification of these molecules, it has been found out that they do not work exactly the way people thought they were working. And because of that, pharma has found that in the first generation drugs, there is either a lot of non-responders or there's a lot of side effects, like Eric pointed out with the TZD, rosiglitazone, which gives a lot of side effects. So what we want to do with our technology is assist or support pharma on various levels to design better drugs in which this block can only become bigger and these two can be smaller, so that the drugs will be much better and have more responders. Okay, so in the drug development pipeline with the nucleoceptor as a target, the initial things that are done is that a library is made against a target, and then finally a screen has been done and the binders have been selected, and then we end up at this stage more or less. And then people want to do lead optimization. And so basically what they're looking for is a functional assay. And as far as the generic ways of nucleoceptor testing is done, for a pharma, nucleoceptor activity is gene transcription. And so they have a nucleoceptor model. They put in a compound and transcription comes out. But basically this is a black box model, because as Eric has pointed out, there's these interactions of nucleoceptors with co-regulators. And basically, transcription is not the activity of nucleoceptors, but transcription is the net result of all these individual interactions of the nucleoceptor with different co-regulators. And these co-regulators are expressed in cell type-specific ways, and that might be the explanation that the drugs work in some tissues and do not work in others, and it can also be the explanation for the fact that some drugs give you side effects in some, and some other drugs do not. And so it would be very valuable information for a pharma to at least find out potentially which interactions can be modified by your compound. And so the idea behind this is that two compounds that give you the same interaction profile probably in vivo do the same, and that compounds who have a differential profile do something different in vivo. Okay, so Eric explained it with a little different cartoon, but I will do it again, so it's a little bit of a light figure. So basically, nucleoceptors, which consist of this DNA binding domain, which bind to the response element of the gene, which they regulate, and a ligand binding domain, which is regulated by the natural ligand or the drug that you want to make. And then there is this interaction surface between the LBD and the co-regulator. And I zoom in on that over here. And as Eric also pointed out, there is this LX6LA motif, so a single leucine and a double leucine separated by two variable amino acids in an alpha helical structure, which basically form the interaction site of the nucleoceptor with the co-regulator. And what we have done from a set of co-regulators, we have taken the LX6LA motif, just like we've for the kinases, we've taken the kinase substrate, and we have immobilized them on the chip. And then in the assay mix, you put your nucleoceptor of choice and a detecting antibody, and what you can then do is you can functionally analyze the effect of a ligand. So the ligand induces a conformational change of the receptor, and hence the binding of the receptor is enhanced or decreased. So how does it look if you look to an array? So here you see an array in which we spotted, and the chips that were shown by Eric were first generation. This is the newest generation chip, which has up to 155 different co-regulators, co-regulator motifs. They come from 65 different proteins, because some co-regulators contain multiple motifs. And basically what you do here is you measure, there is a binding interaction which goes into an equilibrium of the nucleoreceptor and an immobilized co-regulator, which reaches an equilibrium. So as you can see here, in a state, in a control state, so in the APO protein without any ligand, there is already some constitutive binding to some co-regulators, but not to others. And then what you do by adding a ligand, this equilibrium is shifted, and so because of the conformational change, the affinity for the different co-regulator changes, and that is what you see over here. So as an example, the conformational change of a nucleoreceptor with this co-regulator was actually, the affinity was enhanced. The example is shown over here. So for example, here you don't see binding, and the binding here is tremendously increased. But another co-regulator to which the receptor was already bound is lost upon adding of a ligand. So the receptor forms a complex with the ligand, and the co-regulator is lost. That's what's happening here. And we know that these motifs are derived respectively from a coactivator. So binding to a coactivator was going up, and binding to a co-repressor was going down. So clearly we're talking about an agonist over here, and it is because we know here that this is the famous PPAR gamma that Eric was talking about. And this is PPAR gamma with rosiglitazone, which is the known agonist. So that is our system, and it basically does a functional analysis of the receptor like it does with kinases. Okay, so this is proteomics, so it's a lot of data, and I've seen a lot of heat maps. It might be that my heat maps show a little bit different information, so I decided to go step by step in how we analyze that data. So in the previous slide, I showed you a typical experiment in which we do receptor with and without ligand. And so we do that on multiple arrays as technical replicates, and that's what you see over here. So what you see here is the binding of the nucleoreceptor with one of those spots of the array, measured on four technical replicates in the presence of a solvent only, in the presence of the ligand, and what we're measuring here is LXR, LXR alpha, in the presence of a reference agonist. What you see here, the binding goes up, so we can calculate the average of the solvent only, and the average binding goes up in the presence of a ligand. We can even do some statistics there to see if this modulation is significant. And then what we do is we take the ratio of binding in the presence of the ligand over that in the absence of ligand. So that's the ratio. But to be able to compare upregulation and downregulation, we do a log transformation on that. And so this is a single interaction, and since we have 155, we can make a modulation profile or a modulation signature of 155 modulations. So each peak over here represents the modulation that is the modulation of binding to a particular co-regulator because of the ligand. And this response signature, well, it's really a signature. So it's specific for this compound, and you can use this signature to compare different compounds. And that's what we are offering to pharma as a service. So to go from this profile to a heat map, I'd like to introduce one more step. So basically what you do here, this is the same profile as I showed previously, and you can do a small conversion towards a bar graph, so that's EE. So the amplitude of the point is correlated with the extent of the modulation. What you can then add is a coloring information in which the color, the intensity of the color, is correlated with the extent. So basically this high peak over here is intense red. The redness gives you exactly the same information as the amplitude of the peak. So the amplitude of the peak can be taken away, and then you can combine the color-coded profiles of multiple compounds. So that's what you see over here, a heat map. So my heat map tells you whether binding has gone up in the presence of a compound or whether it has gone down in blue. And so in this particular study, which was one of the first studies we did together with Merck, we tested a set of 31 different ligands for PPAR gamma. And so it's a small array, but it serves the purpose to show what we can do with this data. So each row over here is a color-coded signature of each compound. And what we've done then is apply a clustering And that means that if two compounds give you the same profile, they will cluster together and be more adjacent. So compounds that do the same here and are adjacent most probably will also do the same in vivo. That's the whole idea behind it. And what you see, for example, here, there's a compound that does almost nothing. And afterwards we heard that this was a PPAR delta agonist. So this shows you that it's actually specific for that receptor, but not for this receptor. Here we see a compound that actually reduces the binding to most interactions, to most co-regulators. And of course the clustering, what you can do for the compounds, you can also do for the peptides. So we see this blue band over here. These are all peptides that are derived from co-repressors. So probably we're looking at a set of agonists over here. Activators go up and repressors go down. Okay, so if we zoom in and we take this same heat map and we gray it out, I would like to point out a few things of what you can do with this data. So if we would have taken the conventional way that is done by pharma, because these interactions can also be measured by FRET, you have to select a set of peptides because that's not unlimited. I mean, we can do 155 in one go, but for a FRET, you have to set up an assay for each different peptide. So let's assume pharma has gone very far and has taken four FRET assays. If you would have chosen these four peptides over here, you would say that all these compounds probably do the same. And that's the mistake that has been made often. So people classify agonist and antagonist. Compounds are in the same group. And then later on in the higher level biological models, it turns out that these compounds do not all do the same. And so that mistake can be made here. You can conclude that all these compounds are probably doing the same in vivo. However, if you add more data points, you will see that these compounds become different. So for example, while all the compounds in this cluster tend to decrease the binding to co-repressors, there's actually one compound who actually enhances the binding to a co-repressor. So you can imagine that this has a tremendous effect on its in vivo function. And so the take-home message here is that if you increase the number of motifs or increase the number of interactions, you'll have a system in which you have a higher discriminative power in which you can have a better classification of your compounds. Okay, so this was on the small chip. And we did basically the same exercise again with Merck, but now on the estrogen receptor alpha, and we profiled 80 compounds. And what you can see from this graph, and we took a little bit of different color coding, so red means upregulation of binding and green means downregulation. This is a set of 80 compounds, and these are all the peptides. And if we do a clustering, then what we see is that the compounds fall into two groups. There's a group of agonists and a group of antagonists. And you would say, well, if you look at this, it is probably possible to do this whole selection with only a peptide over here. Well, that's not exactly the case. If you zoom in on the data, you see that there's this class of peptides over here, A and B, which basically could group this into two groups. But now if you zoom in on this peptide over here, peptide X, it looks like all these agonists actually upregulate the binding to this peptide. But there is a small subset of antagonists which also does exactly the same. And so when these data were shown at Merck, they actually went back and they had these three peptides synthesized and went back to their HD-FRET assay. And they took their whole library again. And so if you take peptide A and peptide B, which is in the group in which it looks like you only need one peptide to bind these compounds, you see indeed that this is one big cluster of compounds which do more or less of the same. However, if you would plot this behavior against peptide X, they actually saw that their library fell apart in multiple groups. And since there was an arrow here, there's one compound which was of high interest, this whole library and this whole novel compound class might be of high interest. So that's an example of what you can do at the lead optimization stage. Another thing, so you might ask yourself, so these profiles that you see, do they make sense? So coming a little bit closer to biology, this is an example, I think a very nice example of what you can do if you correlate the data with crystallography data. So again, a heat map in which red means upregulation of binding and green means downregulation of binding. This is a subset of the peptides. And what you see here, there is a set of compounds in which gradually the compound on the left-hand side tend to enhance the binding to these co-regulators, but the more you go to the right, it looks like the compounds start repulsing the peptides. And so if you align this with some of the compounds and some of the crystal structures that have been made of these, so there's one here which is in the red end, but there's also a few on the green end, what you see then is that, what you see here is the compound which is lying in the groove where the compounds are bind in the nucleus receptor. And here on top, there's a methionine side chain of the nucleus receptor. And it looks like that the more you go to the right, so the more the compound starts to repulse the binding to the peptide, the side chain of the compound actually clashes with the methionine in the receptor. So I don't know if there are any people who do crystallography here in this room, but this takes 1 hour, and this takes half a year. So you can imagine if you can build a model like this, then the technology will become a very important tool in QSAR. And so you can ask again. So I've shown you, we see these profiles. We can see differences between the profiles. It looks like you can get some correlation with crystallography, but doesn't have anything to do with biology. And so this is a very nice example in a study we did together with a small company on the West Coast, and together with Onno Meijer from the University of Leiden, in which this company is looking for treatment of people with psychotic depression. And the problem with these people, the problem they have is that they have raised cortisol levels, and cortisol levels actually activate the glucocorticoid receptor in the body, and this is giving you all these psychotic problems. So the main target of what you want to do is you want to target GR and bring its activity down. So you could work with a GR antagonist. So that's what people have been trying. And so we did this study. And one of the things that this company has succeeded is the application of RU486, which is a known GR antagonist. It's also known as the morning after pill, as a treatment for psychotic depression. But, well, you can imagine that the morning after pill also has some side effects on that. And apart from that, an important side effect of GR antagonists, which are not so selective, is the fact that GR not only causes this trouble in the body, but GR is also involved in a negative feedback loop. So when the GR is activated, it actually shuts down this whole HPA axis and the cortisol levels go down. If you add a GR antagonist, this negative feedback is also blocked, and the cortisol levels actually go up, and it's also giving you a lot of side effects. So what these people are looking for is a compound that actually blocks over here, but does not block over here. And so in their screening of their compounds, they had a compound which was called C108-297, which had a preferential, a nice pharmacological profile, which they could not explain yet. And so they decided to test that in our assay. And I will not show you the heat map, but basically what I show you here is the interaction of GR with only a single, with four different important NR boxes, which all come from the same protein. So I told you some coregulators have multiple NR boxes, and it's not completely known what the function of all these differences are, but there might be an explanation for this mechanism here. So what we've shown in our data is that if you take the receptor and you incubate it with DMSO, there's almost no binding to neither of these boxes, of these LX6LL motifs. If you add dexamethasone, which is basically a synthetic cortisol, you see that the binding goes up, so that's exactly what you expect. If you add an antagonist, you see that the binding goes down, so those are the blue bars over here. And you also see that same effect with their compound. So there's an antagonism over here, except for motif number four. So in motif number four, the regular antagonist is indeed an antagonist, while their compound is only a partial antagonist or maybe even an agonist. So what that probably means, because what you should know is that these four boxes are part of SRC1, but SRC1 is in the body in two different splice variants. So there's an SRCE, SRC1E, and an SRC1A. And only splice variant SRC1A has box 4. So this effect, what you see over here, this attraction of a coregulator, only takes place in splice variant A. And luckily, this splice variant A is very highly expressed in the part of the brain where the negative feedback is taking place. So this might be a potential mechanism why their compound does good where it should do good, but does not do bad where it not should do bad. Something like that. When I practiced that, that came out better in my head. Okay, so that's a very nice example. So thus far, what the data I've shown is done with... so that's the explanation. So probably there is a decreased disinhibition of the negative feedback loop. And so the data I've shown you thus far is with the ligand-binding domain. So as you remember, the receptor consists of a ligand-binding domain and a DNA-binding domain. And the reason we work with LBD, and most people who work with purified nuc receptors work with LBD, is the fact that it's almost impossible to purify full-length, active full-length nuc receptor. So we thought, of course, everybody, when you come with an LBD, everybody says, why don't you have an assay for a full-length receptor? It's always like that. So we thought, if we cannot purify it, let's not purify it and work with a crude lysate. So the next data I'm going to show you are done with full-length receptors in a crude lysate. And so we started out, and it's also nice because these full-length crude lysates are basically around in every lab. So every lab who works on a nuc receptor has these expression systems with nuc receptors. So it's actually, everybody can use it. And so we went to the National Cancer Institute in Amsterdam, the group of Rob Michalides, and they were actually working with a model system, a cellular model system, in which they transfected a full-length estrogen receptor alpha, which was flanked on either side for YFP and CFP. And so they used this for intramolecular FRET. And so we said, well, can we borrow this system? We make a lysate and we analyze it. So that's what we did. And so their interest was the fact that, I should say that. The reason people like to work with full-length receptor is that, and that's also playing a role in personalized medicine, is that post-translational modifications taking place in the DBD, like phosphorylations, also affect the functionality of the receptor. And so you would like to study that. And so what Rob liked to study was the fact was the phosphorylation at position 305, serine 305, on the activity. And this phosphorylation was already linked to resistance to endocrine treatment in breast cancer. And so there was a correlation, but there was not really a mechanism for that. So we decided to functionally analyze the effect of serine 305 phosphorylation on the activity of the receptor. So we borrowed their model system, in which the receptor is transfected in U2OS cells. And so to phosphorylate the receptor, you add cyclic AMP. Cyclic AMP activates pKa. pKa phosphorylates the receptor, and you can measure that. And so as a counterpart, there was also a same system in which we transfected with the mutant, in which the serine is mutated out, which cannot be phosphorylated. And so that is, we made a lysate, and to see that this system works, we show here the phosphorylation. So here you have the wild type, which upon addition of cyclic AMP becomes phosphorylated, and if you knocked it out, phosphorylation is gone. And so what happens if you take those lysates and you put those on the chip? And so what we did is we did an ELISA, and so we compare normalized inputs of ER-alpha. So on all arrays, there's the same amount of ER-alpha. And so after lysis, you can still add ligand to these preparations, and it's not very clear, but first, we make a dose-response curve with estradiol on the mutated form. So this is the purely unphosphorylated form. And it's not clear, but if you blow up the scale, it's a beautiful dose-response curve. It just looks like this, but we have to blow up the scale. Because if we use the fully phosphorylated receptor, we actually see two things. One thing is, at the left-hand side, where there's virtually no ligand, the receptor starts strongly binding coregulators, so it becomes ligand-independent. And on the right-hand side, where there's a saturating amount of ligand, the response to estradiol is much stronger. So there's two things. Phosphorylation means that the receptor becomes active in absence of ligand, and it becomes more responsive to ligand. Well, I can imagine all kinds of ways that this plays a role in resistance towards drug treatment. And so there was something white out, but there was a white block over it to make this clear. But we also had some intermediate samples in which we had the wild type without phosphorylation, which it looks like there is a little bit of increase here. And there's also the mutant, which also responds to cyclic AMP. And we found out that pKa has an additional phosphorylation site, which apparently also enhances the activity of the receptor. Okay, so you do this in a model system. And when you do it in a model system, people say, yeah, well, how does it translate to in vivo? So we took it one step further, and we took patient material. So we went again to the Dutch Cancer Institute, and we asked them for resection material of an ER-alpha positive breast cancer. So we took two patients, patient A, patient B, both positive for ER-alpha, and we performed this screen for serine 305 phosphorylation. Tumor A, not phosphorylated. Tumor B, a phosphorylated ER-alpha on serine 305. And we decided to functionally analyze that. And what I should tell you is that we also had the clinical follow-up of these two patients. So the non-phosphorylated patient lived for another 13 years after treatment with tamoxifen. This patient died after 9 months. So you can say there's quite a difference in sensitivity towards the treatment. So what did we do? We took those breast materials, histology was done, you have the non-phosphorylated and the phosphorylated. We make a lysate functional analysis. So on the left-hand side is the binding profile of tumor A, of the non-phosphorylated receptor, and on the right-hand side there is the binding profile to all these co-regulators of the phosphorylated receptor. And you see that they both bind very nicely. But if you take a close look, you see that the scale of both graphs is tremendously different. So if we superimpose those two, we put everything on the same scale, you see that the binding activity of the phosphorylated receptor, like in the model system, is dramatically increased. So it looks, again, also in patient material, that although we put the same amount of ER-alpha in, the binding activity of the phosphorylated receptor is much higher. Now, of course, you could argue that in this patient, there was a high endogenous level of estradiol. So to take away that criticism, what we did is we took those samples again and we added estradiol onto the chip. So we activate the receptor, it's still active. And what you see, again the same as in the model system, is that both receptors are responsive to estradiol, but again, the phosphorylated receptor responds much higher to the estradiol. So of course, we could not. The only way to modulate this is we were wondering whether could really be attributed to the phosphorylation of the receptor. So what we did is we left these samples treated with estradiol, and then we decided to treat the lysate with the phosphatase just to cleave off the phosphate of the receptor. That's what you see here. This is a non-phosphorylated sample, so no change. And here, the phosphorylated tumor, if you treat it with a phosphatase, the phosphorylation level goes down. And immediately you see that on the non-phosphorylated receptor, there's absolutely, virtually no effect. But the binding status of the now unphosphorylated receptor drops down to the level of the one that was originally unphosphorylated. And so we can speculate a little bit on the mechanism of why serine 305 phosphorylation is related to resistance in breast cancer, and so this is speculative, but it's still nice to do. So let's assume that in our model system, what we did is we also did, and this is a typo over here, this is actually tamoxifen. So this is a titration of the receptor, the binding level of a non-phosphorylated receptor, which is much lower than compared to that one of a phosphorylated receptor. And if we titrate in tamoxifen, we'll see that tamoxifen always works. So, and if you look at the potency of tamoxifen, it's also unchanged. So that potency cannot be the explanation for resistance of breast cancer. But now let's go to a different treatment. So a different treatment of breast cancer is Arimidex. And what Arimidex does, it basically inhibits the formation of estradiol. So that should take away the driving force of the estrogen receptor and should silence the estrogen receptor. But now if you have a receptor which is phosphorylated and becomes ligand independent, you're probably not sensitive to this treatment. So this might be a rationale for sensitivity towards Arimidex treatment. And if we go to tamoxifen, so I looked around, and if you see the dosage of tamoxifen, it doesn't matter whether you are this small or this big, everybody gets 20 milligrams per day. So as long as you're not swallowing a concentration which brings your concentration up to here and completely stops the receptor, your residual activity in a phosphorylated receptor is much higher than in a non-phosphorylated receptor. So I think this can be an escape mechanism also for treatment. And it's now we're now in a pharma setting. This session is about pharma, but of course we could bring it back also to the personalized medicine session that was before. So what is done now in the treatment of breast cancer is that people look for abundance of the estrogen receptor alpha. So are you ER alpha positive? So if you are, then apart from an operation and a chemo, you get endocrine treatment. But of course there are various escape mechanisms which can be formed by kinases. And if there is an escape mechanism which either takes a survival pathway and makes you ER alpha independent, or there is a pathway, which I've just demonstrated in the previous slides, that phosphorylates the receptor and makes it less sensitive to your treatment, you have a recurrence of tumors. And now luckily there is a company who makes chips in which you can functionally analyze kinases and nuc receptors in the same sample. And so that may help you to select whether you should give a certain treatment in endocrine treatment. But apart from that, you can give a combination therapy in which you block the phosphorylation of the receptor, make the patient more sensitive to endocrine treatment again, and apart from that, also block all kinds of survival pathways. And the first trials of doing this have already shown that this is possible. So patients that were resistant towards endocrine treatment were actually made sensitive again after addition of a kinase inhibitor towards a kinase, which it is known that it phosphorylates ER alpha. Okay, so bring this back to a conclusion. So I started off with saying that probably pharma is not making very perfect drugs yet because we don't know nuc receptor activity very well yet. And so what we have learned and what is becoming more and more clear in literature is that activity, which we target, is defined by the nuc receptor itself, by the drug, but also by all kinds of factors in the patient. And these factors can be post-translational modifications, it can be mutations, like Eric pointed out, splice variants, and all kinds of other stuff. And so if we are learning how this works, and we bring that back to the pharma, we might be able to design better drugs. So all those information can turn into prediction markers, and so bring it all completely together to where I started, is that we're targeting nuc receptor activity. Pharma is using this pipeline, and what I've shown you, hopefully, is that we can support this part of the development process. We do so by using our assay, which can serve as some sort of an ex vivo sensor for nuc receptor function. We can use nuc receptors from different sources, so we can use patient material, we can use preclinical models in which the receptor is decorated, and with decorated I mean phosphorylated or methylated, and we can also use recombinant proteins. And the nice thing about the fact that we can measure these receptor, the same receptor from different sources, comes down to this, is the fact that if we learn that what goes wrong in the patient, those markers can be brought back to the preclinical models, and that enables us to select better preclinical models, which can do better translational research. And even if in those preclinical models you find out which phosphorylation sites are the important phosphorylation sites, for example, you can make a recombinant system in which that phosphorylation is taking place, and you can actually do your initial screening already more efficiently. Okay, and with that, in the background, a picture that was taken exactly a week ago on my holidays. I'd like to thank some people. Oh, there was PemGene's blackout. So I'd like to thank Eric and Ari for designing the new chip with us. Rob Michalias for the work on the cancer, on the Netherlands Cancer Institute. Onno Meijer for the work on the glucocorticoid receptor antagonist. Sean Martens and Sean Fuchs for providing us with samples to develop this assay. And last but not least, Diana Melges, who has provided me with all this data to present to you. Thank you.